Okay, in chapter 4, we talk about dirt. It kind of goes right along with diapers and sippy cups. We even started to go into that last time too. You can't kind of stay away, right? Let's think about dirt for just a moment though. Given the chance, do you go camping where it's a little dirty, or are you a hotel guy? If you had
man, I am outdoors. I'll dig my own toilet if I have to. I like the outdoors. My family, we do go camping, but they like the KOA.
Okay.
You know, a Wi-Fi and a pool, and they'll sleep in the tent at night. If I'm actually physically in danger, I'm probably happiest when I'm camping.
One of the great experiences in my life was a week spent with a bunch of guys hiking the Adirondacks with nothing but whatever we carried in, you know, and we did have tents and things too, but you know, you're kind of at the mercy, so to speak, of nature, and it was great. We mentioned too about creation and being in it. I love talking about creation. Again, there's a lot of great things that we can learn from the first couple chapters of Genesis.
Yeah.
I think they're often the key to understanding a lot more about who Jesus is and what he's done. But I like asking this question. So on creation, why did God create us and everything else that we see? How would you answer that? What is the meaning or the purpose of God's creation?
Thanks for giving me the softball question here, Pastor.
You're welcome.
I think one thing you do have to say is that God didn't need to. And there are these, the creation myths from other religions, and we believe those are not biblical and there are false myths. It's very interesting if you actually read them and you contrast them with our Genesis account, the true account. Sometimes it was a mistake. Sometimes there was a battle that happened. Sometimes it was a result of the need of the gods to do something, or they needed to create the world so that they could have fun or abuse the world. Sometimes it was a deformity even. I mean, it's if you read those creation accounts, there's a great contrast between the true account from Genesis, which is that out of love, out of an abundance of his love, overflows from God this beautiful, good, real creation. God doesn't like get in a fight with somebody and then the mistake is the creation. God doesn't tear a piece of himself out and throw it down and, you know, that's the creation. But it's created good, it's created out of love, and it's real. And the reality of the physical part of it is good. Whereas many other creation accounts, it's like the ideal is the dreamlike, you know, ethereal world, and the physical part is like a corruption of it. And that's not the case when we read the Genesis account.
Yeah, now you're jumping ahead.
Oh, sorry. There. Okay, yeah.
I'm getting there in my questions, but I appreciate your answer. I like that. And I liked your insight that one of the first things to realize is he didn't need to. My answer to the question, something I learned from Dr. Masaki at Fort Wayne Seminary. I love this answer. This is now my answer too. And it goes right along with what you said. I think a lot of people think, and maybe even some of these myths of creation, is that, you know, the gods created us so that we could serve that God or do things for them. And you rightly pointed out, like, God doesn't need us to do that. But it's actually the opposite, I think, is true. God created us so that he could serve us. That out of the abundance of love, he could then engage with the real and the physical world that he created and pour himself into it even more. And I think that's evidenced by Jesus, who left heaven to come down and serve. Scriptures tell us that if we want to know God, we look at Jesus. So what does Jesus do? He comes to serve. And so to me, that answer really resonates, that truly the heart of God is always service and always pouring out, never demanding something that we give to him, but it's always pouring out an abundance of blessing on his creation.
I think of that wonderful passage in Philippians chapter 2, which is Christ did not consider equality with God something to be grasped. So it's not something that he holds on to or holds up, but rather he lets go and places himself under others. And how different that is than our sinful condition.
Yeah, in a in a way too, maybe this is helpful to us. It didn't matter to him what status he held, right? It was out of love that he decided to do what he needed to do.
Yeah.
And I think that's good for all of us too, that love is love can be messy. Love can certainly get us dirty. Love can lead us to hurt, but love is what God does. Letting go of the thing that you think is so important, and simply then we'll bring it back to some of these previous chapters, being present with the person who needs you right here and now.
Yeah.
And that's how God shows love. He shows up right there. He doesn't wait for us to get up to him or I'll see you in a few years when you figure it out. It's like, you know what? I'm coming down. I'll be there. And you mentioned this too, right away in the chapter. This is one of the very first things you write, that God made the creation real, physical, corporeal, flesh, blood, bones, and God said it was good. And you started to go in this too. I think sometimes we get the sense, and admittedly too, even as a pastor sometimes, even though I would subconsciously, I think sometimes I weave into my teaching or preaching that the physical is bad, or at the very most neutral, but that somehow this spiritual life is the thing that we're really aiming at. But that contradicts what we confess in the creed, right? That Christ is going to return and all things will be made new and real. So yeah. The future isn't floating on clouds as spiritual beings. The future that God's promised is a real, physical, yet perfect, fully redeemed and restored creation.
I might maybe just add to that this idea that the physical, in this chapter, it gets a little detailed in terms of some church history and some early heresies, but this idea that the physical is less and bad, whereas the escape and the spiritual and the ethereal is good and closer to God, that's a false teaching. I mean, we know that we're sinful, but we're sinful in body, mind, and spirit. You know, it's not like our spirits are less sinful than our bodies. we're all sinful, and that's why God has completely redeemed us. And when you think about the physicality of Christ's work of redemption, becoming real flesh and blood, not fake or pretend flesh and blood. I mean, was it just pretend that he was bleeding? Was that just a pretend thing? No, that was real.
Yeah.
And that he hugged people. He took the children into his arms. He ate with his disciples. And then, you know, after the resurrection, he physically appears to them. They touch him. He eats with them. And that's a sign that our physical life is redeemed now. Mm-hmm. And that when we look for the callings that we have in life, we've got to be careful not just to look to the super spiritual things, but look to the physical things, the everyday things of our lives.
I think as we've been talking, to maybe reverse the thinking and see that some of this, what we might call the super spiritual, are grounded in something real and even mundane, that God works through those things. I think one of the reasons we think about the physical world as being bad, we've talked about this, we do see evidence of brokenness, yeah. Right? And certainly the physical creation, things break down, right? I'm getting, every time I look in the mirror, there's another gray hair, there's another wrinkle, my bones are creaking more than they did yesterday. We see and experience creation crumbling around us. God's promises he'll make all things new. I was particularly interested in your the way that you describe, though, how sin came into the world and how this brokenness happened, right? It often, and in many Bibles, it's described as the fall into sin. And you talk about it being a climb. And I like that because as I teach in confirmation, the fall into sin looks less like a fall and more like a giant leap. You know, like Adam and Eve didn't trip over a tree branch and suddenly find that a fruit was in their mouth. Like, oh, like, I'm sorry, I ate it. Like, no, they intentionally chose to dive in full on into this sin. It wasn't an accident. They chose that. I think a lot of times we then, I don't, let me know if you think I'm on with this or not. I think a lot, if we want to kind of generalize what sin is still today, it's really just a rebranding or a rehashing or a revisiting of that original sin,
yeah.
Which is that we desire something more,
yeah.
Something that we think is greater than what God has already given to us.
Yes. I think that you're right on with that. And In the book, I talk about, of course, we accept you and we accept that the church is teaching on original sin, and it's fine to talk about the fall into sin, but it's actually not a biblical word. The Bible doesn't actually literally use the word fall.
Right.
And if you read the Genesis account, what does Satan say? He said, the temptation is you will be like God. Mm-hmm. That's not going down, that's going up.
Right.
And so they're not content in being just creatures given these gifts by God to love and to serve one another. They want something more. And so they climb over each other and over the serpent and try to climb their way up to be like God. It's the same temptation when the disciples are with Jesus and they say, you know, we've been talking and, you know, who's the greatest among us? Because we want the seats of honor, one on your right and one on your left. It's that same temptation. We want to be greater than one another. We want to be like God. And so that's why I describe it as a climb into sin.
Yeah.
Of course, it's rightly understood as a fall because we've fallen away from God. But I also like your point about, like, it's not just, whoops, oh, how did that happen?
Right.
That original sin is this irrational power that infects and affects all of us equally, which is to climb above one another and to displace God.
And we do that daily.
We do that daily, and we have to repent of it daily. And
we come back to some of these grounding things we've talked about before with the word and the sacrament, these gifts that God's given us that we can repeatedly come back to and see his grace and his restoration, his redemption, full force.
And I think maybe the word and sacrament too, this, think about the sacraments. They're physical things.
Yeah.
It's real water. It's bread and wine poured over us or consumed by us. It's no accident that God is doing these extraordinary things through the ordinary.
Especially nowadays, because we're taking communion out of a Ziploc bag, right? Everyone comes into church and they get their elements. I actually appreciate this right now because I tell everyone to take it out and hold them in your hands. And as you hold these simple things in your hands, you're holding the very means of your salvation. Christ says, this is my body and this is my blood. So you're holding in your hands Christ's body and blood, which was given for you for the forgiveness of your sins on the cross. You're holding salvation in your hand, and then you get to eat it and it becomes a part of you. You are what you eat, right? You become righteousness because God puts his righteousness in you, and that he does that through simple, ordinary, physical things by which he does extraordinary things.
Yeah. It's also a reminder then, all right, so where are you going to look to find your callings? If Christ came down, became flesh for us, if Christ suffered and died for us, if the means of our salvation are in normal, everyday words, bread and wine and water, so where should you start looking for your callings?
Mm.
Probably in the same places, the earthly dirt, in the dirt, right? In the dirt of our everyday existence. That's where they start.
You ended that so well, it was like we planned it. So we might as well leave it there.
Let's leave it there.